Okay, guys. So, chapter 2 in the Menchaca book, racial formation. Let's start off by talking about Columbus, right? If you grew up in the United States, at least when I was a little squirt, I went to kindergarten back in, good Lord, 1971, something like that. We learned this little, like a nursery rhyme. In 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue, right? Well, here's Columbus. The first landing of Columbus, discovering America and all that. He discovered it from the point of view of the old world, of Europe, Eurasia. Didn't discover it from the point of view of Native Americans, the Indians, the peoples of North and South America, etc. Okay, let's get over all of that. The bottom line is that in 1492, Columbus made the first of four voyages to the Americas. I'm using this map not because we're going to talk about all these different explorers and etc., but just so that we can look for a moment at the kind of trajectory here, okay, of Spain. 1493, the trajectory of Columbus's first voyage. He made it over under the periphery of the islands of the Caribbean, and he went back, okay? The important thing to make note of here is that he arrived at an island that he named Hispaniola, or Hispaniola, if you want to put a little inflection into it. Today, that island is divided into two countries, Haiti and the Dominican Republic. When he left Hispaniola to go back to Spain to report to the king and queen that he had found what he thought was the edge of Asia, he thought that he was on the periphery of China and or Japan. When he left a bunch of sailors, a bunch of his men behind, telling them, look, set up a village here, establish a nice relationship with these Indians, because he thought he was near India, China, Japan, right? We'll be back in 6 months, okay? We expect to find a nice kind of setup here that you guys have smoothed out a great relationship with these folks. We got the ball rolling here. Now it's up to you guys to kind of take the ball and run with it, and, we'll see you in 6 months. Well, the thing is, he didn't get back for 2 years. Okay, now I don't know about you guys, but I'm very punctual. I'm not just on time for everything. I'm like a half an hour early for everything. You may like that, not like a whatever, but I'm anal about being on time. That's my thing, okay? If anybody is like 5 minutes late for a date or a meeting or whatever, I get bugged. If they're a half an hour or an hour late, I get worried, I get irritated, I get angry, depending on whatever the circumstances are. If dude was supposed to be back in 6 months and he's 2 years late, I'm going to be out of my mind. Trust me, when Columbus showed up 2 years later, these guys were out of their freaking minds. They had tried to take over the island, so to speak, or basically take over from the Indians. They'd tried to enslave the Indians. What Columbus basically discovered when he got back was a state of kind of, hostilities, to put it mildly, with the Indians. A kind of state of warfare existed between the Spanish and the Indians. Because the Spanish assumed that they'd been left there forever. And their attitude was, well, if we've been left here forever, then we're going to take over from these chumps and we're going to run this place, right? Well, when Columbus finally does show up, the Spanish that have been left behind are so angry that the first thing they do is they grab Columbus and the small number of men that he's kind of rowed ashore with, and they overwhelm his landing crew, and they're going to kill him. They're actually going to hang him, okay? They've got his life in their hands. And they say, dude, you're dead. You left us here for 2 years, 18 months late, sucker. Okay, the only way that Columbus can save his neck, save himself from being hung, is he promises to give all these men a grant of encomienda. Okay, encomienda is the thing that they want in return for Columbus's life. All right, now, what is an encomienda? Okay, now this is something that is often misunderstood, and I want you guys to understand it very, very specifically. So I've got a couple of things here to hopefully explain it, beginning with this kind of map image that I've drawn myself to give you a sense of this, okay? A grant of encomienda is not a grant or a gift that gives you possession of a piece of land. What it gives the encomendero, or the person who receives the grant of encomienda, it gives them control, okay, over the labor or the human beings that live on a certain piece of real estate defined on a map. Okay, so let's look at this map right here for a minute. All right, here's a mountain range or a range of, you know, big hills or whatever. Here's the coast, the ocean. It could even be a giant river if you want. Let's call it the ocean, okay? Here are a bunch of rivers. Yeah, I wanted it to be the ocean. I'm remembering now, okay? Here are a bunch of rivers coming down from the mountains, feeding into the ocean through a lake in this instance, right? Okay. Now, here is number one encomienda, number two, number three, number four. This encomienda is defined by the mountain range, the river down to the lake, and then by this dotted line down to a double peaked, like, hilltop that's at the coast, right? Okay? Now, within this grant of encomienda, you have one village of Indians, another village of Indians. You have three Indian villages. Okay, here's the second encomienda, defined from the two peaked hilltop up that dotted line to the lake and the river, to the mountains, right? And then over here to this river, and then down over, well, I don't know if I had it to this river or to this one. I had it to this river, actually, okay? And to this river. There's one village, two village, three villages here, too. Pretty fair spread, right? Three villages. Here's the third encomienda. This is, you know, Julio Rodriguez. This is Juan Alvarez, okay? This is Pedro Herreras, and this is Emigdio Rodriguez, okay, whatever, okay? So here's the third one, right? This one goes from this river. Now it's bisected by a river, but it goes to this one. It's got this forest up here near the mountains, right? It goes to this dotted line. It's got two villages within it, not quite as populous, but maybe these villages are slightly denser in terms of population, who knows? Here's a fourth one. It goes off the map. It's got three villages, maybe more, but okay. They're kind of divvied up the same in terms of size, water sources, resources in terms of, like, manpower or villages. Four encomiendas. The encomenderos do not own the land. They can't sell the land. They cannot exchange or transact the land, okay? But what they control is the labor upon the land, and they can force the Indians that live upon the land to work for them in whatever capacity that they wish, and to do whatever productive thing they want them to do to generate wealth. Okay? That is what makes a grant of encomienda valuable. Now look, your average grant of encomienda did not have three villages on it. It had 8 or 10 or 12 or something like that, okay? It had thousands of Indians on it, all right? I didn't, you know, I'm trying to make a map here that you guys can make sense of. I'm not going to draw like 95 X's on it and fill it all up with a million little things so that it becomes too complicated to make sense of. But I want you to understand what we're talking about here. These guys asked or forced, demanded from Columbus grants of encomienda because they wanted to get rich, right? The only reason these guys sailed off to the New World was to try to get rich, okay? And so here we are. Think about this. The very first voyage Columbus made, when he came back on the second voyage, because of these odd circumstances of having left these sailors there and then coming back and them being angry because of what he'd done and being late coming back and whatever, a kind of pattern was set into place whereby these Spanish colonists, these men, were able to kind of demand, look, I'm over here, I'm a tough guy, I'm willing to help, to fight, to kind of, you know, put these Indians under control and etc. And what I want, okay, in return for my efforts and risking my life and etc., is I want an encomienda. Now, you guys remember from way back talking about the conquest of the Aztecs and all that, was that this is what the conquistadors wanted, right? Grants and encomienda, okay? Big landed estates, right? And the wealth that came along with them. But this was a pattern that was set in place way beforehand, right at the beginning in the islands when Columbus first kind of started this whole process, right? 30 years before Cortez, this is where all of this started, all right? Now, here's a kind of interesting graphic that I found on the internet that kind of explains, you know, the plan and the reality. This is what encomienda was supposed to be in terms of the way that, you know, that the crown legitimized this. Columbus had to sort of then, you know, send documents off to Spain saying to the crown, well, you know, can we do it like this? And yes, and so on and so forth. And okay, and you know, here's the plan, here's the reality, and you can kind of look this over and let me skip on to the next thing. You can pause and just check this out. Okay, I want to explain this to you. Let me just read this because I really think it's important that you understand the true hard cold dollars and cents value of an encomienda. Let's look at some numbers. Cortez, 30 years later, okay, Cortez received from himself, really, right, and isn't that fun, an encomienda after the conquest, right, of the Aztecs, that consisted of 22 villages where approximately 115,000 Indians lived. According to the law, his own laws, okay, he had the right to make these Indians do anything that he wanted them to do in terms of labor. And all of the wealth derived from that labor belonged, of course, to Hernan Cortez. Now, let's try to look at this in modern terms. I've done some involved math with my little calculator on my iPhone to make sense of it like so. You, okay, you know, in the modern world, right now in the 21st century, you inherit from your uncle or your aunt or whatever you want, your granddad, who has just passed away, control of a great estate in some distant part of the world, okay, upon which 80,000 adult workers live with their children, okay, creating a total population of 115,000 people, okay, children and other dependents, elderly folks, disabled, you know, people, somebody missing a leg or an arm that can't work, you know, everybody, the whole population is going to be that 115,000 people, right? The workers work for 6 days a week, Monday through Saturday, and they generate wealth equaling about $30 an hour, okay? And let's say that what they're manufacturing is clothing. We're talking about sweatshop labor, you know, making pants, shirts, socks, whatever, you know, hoodies, but whatever, clothing. Now, the labor of these people would generate about $630 million every year. Okay? That's $630 million, guys, in a year. The comparisons are not exact because there are many different historical factors that have got to be taken into account. But let's be even more conservative. Let's say that not everyone made out quite as well as Cortez. And certainly there were no other encomenderos in Nueva España or Mexico, okay, who received as much as he did, no question. Cortez was at the top of the pyramid, guys. I mean, he was the alpha male big dog guy who made out the best, for sure, okay? But even if one received an encomienda that would provide him with the modern equivalent of only $1 million per year, that is more money than the majority of Americans will earn in their lifetime, or very close to it. Guys, have you ever tried to plot out how much money you're likely to make in your life? Okay? Most people will not make much more than $1 million in their life. All right? So, this is a fabulous fortune we're talking about. An unbelievable windfall. And it really helps to give you a sense, I hope, of why the Spaniards would take this matter of cheap or free labor as very seriously as they did, guys. We're talking about an unbelievable amount of money. Okay? Here's a famous painting by Diego Rivera, the great Mexican muralist, called The Exploitation of Mexico by Spanish Conquistadors, done in 1938, which just shows you all these different forms, okay, of the exploitation of Indian labor, you know, with the complicity of the Catholic Church, you know, converting the Indians and pacifying them and, you know, talking them into, hey, this is what God wants, you know, and I mean, look, it might be hard here on earth, but, you know, you're going to be forgiven in heaven and taken care of, and your eternal soul will be, you know, taken care of for the rest of eternity, so it's all going to be great, you know, don't worry about how hard it is here on earth, and etc., and it's interesting the way, you know, that in some instances here, you know, Rivera is sort of portraying the Indian, or the Spaniards as these kind of, like, you know, microcephalic idiots with these kind of moron faces and whatever to sort of suggest the degradation of their race and whatever. But again, if you just look, you know, sort of into the background here at the things that the Indians are doing to generate wealth, and you see that the hangings, the sort of, you know, the punishment of the Indians, you know, for disobeying or not working hard enough and so on and so forth. It's a really interesting painting if you look at it in detail, and you can certainly call it up on the internet just by the title, and you can enlarge it and look, you know, at the little pieces of it here and there. It's well worth your attention. Now I want to talk a little bit about something Menchaca touches on, but she doesn't touch on it quite as much as I would like in some ways, so I'm going to talk about it a bit more. And that's the noble savage debates. The Spanish had been arguing over the relative humanity and or inhumanity of the Indians since the turn of the century, since 1500, and the issue of whether Indians had souls had always been, you know, a little typo, my apologies, at the forefront of the debate. Many weak laws had been passed, another typo, sorry, that were supposed to control the conduct of the colonists towards the Indians. And then Carlos I, the King of Spain, had made it illegal to enslave the Indians in 1530, but this had still done little to curb the realities practiced in Spanish America. The thinking was that if a secular law was not enough, then perhaps a papal bull, an order issued by the Pope, would carry sufficient moral authority to force the colonists to change their ways. And so in 1537, Pope Paul III, who you see here at the left, issued Sublimis Dei, the Sublime God, which not only forbade the enslavement of the Indians, but of all other peoples known or to be discovered in the future. And it also made clear that any who opposed this were agents of Satan. In addition, as a result of this bull, the Indians were given the right to own property and were to be mandatorily converted to Christianity. The laws passed to give voice to these orders came to be known as Vitoria's Natural Laws, named for the priest who argued so tirelessly on behalf of the rights of the Indians. Father Francisco de Vitoria saw the issue of Indian rights in black and white terms. The Indians were the true moral owners of their property, meaning essentially their lands, and they could not be considered natural slaves in Aristotelian terms. He also argued that the Spanish had no moral authority to interfere in the lives of the Indians unless it would be to protect innocence in danger of being sacrificed. Vitoria was what you might call an armchair scholar, in the sense that all of his arguments concerning the rights of the Indians were made without his ever having visited the Americas to see things for himself. In understanding the Indians, he relied upon the evidence provided in a short history of destruction of the Indians, which you can see over here to the left, written by Bartolomé de las Casas in 1542, and also published in translation as The Tears of the Indians and as The Spanish Colony. This book, translated into a half dozen European languages, spawned the infamous Black Legend of the Indies, portraying the Spaniards as it did as nothing less than the bloody-handed destroyers of Indian life and civilization in the islands of the Caribbean. The book, I should mention, was written by Bartolomé de las Casas, who you see pictured here in the lithograph at left and in the painting at right. And I'm going to go on to talk about Las Casas here, who is also discussed in your book in the Menchaca text. Now, on the Valladolid debate, in 1550, he and his de Sepulveda, a juridical scholar, and Bartolomé de las Casas engaged in a debate in Valladolid, Spain, ordered by the king on the humanity of the Indians, to be judged by a group of Spanish scholars. Sepulveda spoke first and used as the basis of his arguments the Aristotelian doctrine of the just war. In the 4th century BCE, Aristotle had argued that there were two kinds of men, civilized men, such as the Greeks who lived in cities, and barbarians who did not. He wrote that there were a variety of circumstances under which civilized men were justified in warring against barbarians, among them the enhancement of the strength, resources, and glory of the home state, as well as the subjugation of those who should be governed by others. Barbarians, he further argued, were men whose natural state was slavery. Sepulveda also used the writings of Oviedo, who would describe the Indians as idle, untruthful, evil, undependable, forgetful, and cowardly. None of this surprising, as he had made a lot of money exploiting the Indians. Sepulveda issued 5 primary justifications for the enslavement of the Indians. First of all, he said, their natural condition, which was barbarism, made them fit for slavery, and it was the duty of the Spanish to act as masters. Second, he said the Indians were ignorant, inhuman, and bestial. His third argument was that the Spanish were obligated to prevent Indians from engaging in cannibalism. Fourth, the Spaniards were obligated to prevent the Indians from engaging in the sacrifice of innocents. And fifth, slavery was an effective method of converting Indians to Christianity, and it was the Spaniards' duty to end their idolatry and save their souls. Las Casas himself had been an encomendero decades earlier before undergoing a crisis of faith and giving up his wealth and property to become a Dominican priest. Consequently, he understood the ground Sepulveda was standing on very well. He argued that the writings of Sepulveda were poisonous, and that as people looked up to scholars and doctors of theology, they would swallow all that he wrote uncritically. He also argued that the church only had jurisdiction over those within the church, and not over pagans and unbelievers. They could only be seen as potential converts, and once made Christian, they could not by law be enslaved. Las Casas also claimed that the practice of human sacrifice was only a way to punish criminals. He was not entirely correct here, but we'll forgive him. And besides, the cruel methods of war that Christians employed to make war upon the Indians indiscriminately would be even worse. Lastly, and famously, Las Casas said goodbye to Aristotle, because having been born centuries too early and never knowing of Christ's truth and love, he could not be used as a judge as to whether the Indians were barbarians and thus could justly be enslaved and warred upon. Had he known of and been a Christian, Las Casas argued that Aristotle could have written that they should be loved, as all men are to be loved, being one in Christ. Each side of the debate claimed to have won, although an official verdict was never even delivered by the jury. In the end, Sepulveda's arguments did very little to ease legal controls that had been placed on the encomenderos in terms of their treatment of the Indians, and Las Casas' impassioned plea had little to no effect on the further abuse of the Indians and continuing wars of Spanish conquest of the Americas, unfortunately. In the 2 previous slides, pardon me guys, I need a Ricola, I'm dealing with a terrible cold here. I'm going to start losing my voice a little bit. In the 2 previous slides, you see images from Oviedo's general history showing the genius of Indian agricultural methods, as well as that newfangled Indian invention, the hammock, in addition to the first look Europeans had at the pineapple. To the left is one of the more problematic illustrations from the English translation of the book, a purported scene of full-on horror pornography, Indian cannibalism. To be sure, there were Indian peoples that engaged in some forms of ritualistic cannibalism involving the ingestion of small amounts of human flesh, but nothing like what that illustration shows transpired, or not that any reliable historical source records. Full-on party-down barbecues of human flesh, like an Eli Roth movie? No. But what is also interesting to take note of here is that the Europeans had nothing like barbecue, or barbecue, as it was known amongst the Taino Indians of the Caribbean. And this roasting of meat on raised grills or in a fire pit would be ultimately transformed over time into the world-famous American tradition of barbecue, with all of its many tasty variations. Whether it be Texas Tasty Q, or North Carolina Piedmont style, Kansas City Henry Perry Hickory Smoked, Tennessee Barbecue, or down the hood South Central LA. And if you live in the greater SoCal area, please waste no time in checking out these fine establishments, some of my favorite barbecue joints in the City of Angels. And no, I'm not getting into Terminus, even though it's 1 week away from season 6 of The Walking Dead, guys. We're almost there, and I can hardly wait. Now, some further information on sex and intermarriage. You can pause right here and just read this. There's no reason for me to just read this page here. I can save a little throat energy. Hopefully I don't lose my voice before the video lecture's over. So go ahead, read it. I'm freezing for a minute here. Okay, it must be done now. Let's continue. And let's talk about the rebellion of Africans in colonial Mexico and some notes from Slaves of the White God by Colin Palmer, a book published in 1976 by the University Press out of UCLA. Pardon me, guys, I got a cough here. And a little water. Okay. Slaves in Nueva España were classified into three categories: criollos, bozales, and cimarrones. The first slave rebellion in New Spain had taken place in 1537, when there were approximately 10,000 African slaves in the colony, all of them engaged in silver and gold mining. The plot amongst the slaves began with the idea to slaughter all of the Spaniards in Mexico City and Tlatelolco at midnight on September 25th, 1537. They selected a king from amongst their number, whose name has not survived, to lead the rebellion. A few hours earlier, a fellow slave tipped off the viceroy, and the king was arrested. Runners were sent everywhere to alert the authorities to arrest the other leaders via board of revolt. Many slaves were killed immediately out of fear and anger, while many others fled to the wilds, only to be tracked down by Indians. Few of the runaways were killed, their bodies salted, or five of the runaways were killed, their bodies salted for preservation and presented to the viceroy by Indians for a reward. The consequences of this rebellion were that Viceroy Antonio de Mendoza advised the crown to end the trade in African slaves. He also recommended building a wall around the inner district of the capital, an area that had been laid out by Cortes after the conquest, as a part of the city where only Spaniards would be allowed to live. This was deemed necessary as an act of self-defense in a recently conquered colony where the Spanish were a small minority. Mendoza also called for the conducting of siege drills and the establishment of a major granary for the city in the event of emergency. All of this was ignored, but one measure that was taken was for the institution of a civil militia, the Santa Hermandad, or Holy Sisterhood, in order to maintain law and order in the capital in case of an emergency. The slave trade was not ended because it was far too profitable and slave labor was far too necessary. Instead, it only grew bigger. This had to do not just with profit and necessity, but also with the fact that around the same time the new laws of 1542 were passed, also known as the New Laws of the Indies, and these increased the need for African slaves due to the limitations placed by the crown upon the use of Indian workers. And this was also the time of the noble savage debates, so these things are interconnected. It's a portrait statue of Gaspar Janga in Veracruz, Mexico. We're going to talk about him in the next slide here. Now, the new laws of 1542 were like this: no Indian slavery, a termination, an end of the encomienda system at the end of the lifetimes of the current encomenderos. Indians must be paid wages and must pay tribute to the crown if employed. They also had to be taxed fairly and treated as human beings by the colonial government. Fourth and last, Indians were not to be used in the mines unless out of absolute necessity, right? Only African slaves in the mine works. Now, the above, combined with the epidemics of 1545 and the resultant heavy loss of many Indian lives, only made matters worse in terms of increasing the need for African slaves. As the number of African slaves grew, so too did the numbers of cimarrones, or runaway slaves. These runaways tended to congregate in the mountainous jungles of what is now the state of Veracruz, between the capital and the coast. If you guys ever saw the movie Apocalypto, that mountainous jungle, that terrain, That's where the movie was filmed. Perfect area for slaves to run away and build hidden communities, right, to protect themselves. If you saw the movie, you can dig what I'm talking about. There are the established villages for mutual assistance and survival called palenques. The first palenque of any real import was built in 1570 under the leadership of Gaspar Janga. There's the man. And it lasted for nearly 40 years as a resistance center for Cimarrones so that they could escape the cruelty and treachery of the Spanish who, without any right, had become owners of their freedom. Janga argued that God was with them, which was made clear by their frequent defeat of any Spanish force sent to conquer them. By 1609, Janga was an old man, could no longer lead his people in battle. He delegated as war leader to an Angolan named Francisco de la Mataza. The Spanish got word of this turn of events and determined that they needed to attack before the Cimarrones became too powerful to defeat. All blacks in Veracruz were held there for many days prior to the attack to be sure that no word of it would reach Janga. An army of 540 men went against Janga's 100 warriors, and the Spanish won, burning some 70 buildings and driving the survivors into the surrounding jungle. From there, a guerrilla conflict was waged for the next 5 years by Janga's people until finally, unable to fully defeat the Cimarrones, the Spanish negotiated a very specific peace with the following conditions agreed to by both sides. Pardon me. Another statue of Janga. Number one, the colonial government must build a new town for the people of Janga to be ruled by a cabildo, or town council, of their own selection, which would always include descendants of Janga. Number two, no Spaniards would be allowed to live there. Number three, Janga's people would return, and new runaways that came to them for aid, or any new runaways, sorry, typo there, they would return any new runaways that came to them for aid. Number four, Janga's people would promise to pay tribute to the crown and fight for the colony should the need arise. Number five, their religious needs would be met by Franciscan priests only. We only trusted the Franciscans. No Dominicans, no Jesuits. Okay? By 1618, San Lorenzo de Negras, San Lorenzo of the Blacks, was built, and it is still there today. But now, it is a town named after its founder, the town of Janga. This story reflects several things of importance: the basic desire of slaves for freedom and the need of the Spanish government for acculturation, right? For these slaves to, okay, or former slaves to have their own town, have their own community, but to have it as an acculturated Spanish American or Spanish town, right, within the colony. Okay, now, there had been another abortive rebellion in 1608. The slaves involved met on Christmas Eve in the home of a free mulatto and elected a king and queen, Martin, the slave of Baltasar Reyes, Mexico City's wealthiest man, and Melchora, a free black woman. Other lesser leaders were elected, a feast was consumed, and the next day one of the conspirators tipped off the viceroy, and the Sala del Crimen, or the Hall of Crime, arrested all of those named as co-conspirators. There were 24 arrested, 16 slaves, 8 freedmen, and 6 of the latter were mulattoes. 7 were women, and 5 of these were free. Most of the freedmen, meaning they were free individuals, most of the freedmen were in the employ of the very powerful of Mexico City, the viceroy, the archbishop, etc. What is of interest here is that the slaves, free blacks, and mulattoes all shared a common perspective. Slave owners tried to make light of it as a drunken revel gone too far, out of fear that the deeply concerned colonial government or the crown would abolish slavery. Individuals concluded that many more individuals than those arrested had been involved and had been involved in the plot, and a list of names turned up. As these investigations were being carried out, a slave woman who saw an Indian woman being mistreated by a Spaniard cried out, "It is only a matter of time until the Spaniards and everyone else will be our slaves." Arrested and questioned, she was of use to the government in identifying the others involved in the plot. The government decided to take strong measures and issued the following new laws. No more than 4 slaves could congregate anywhere in the colony. the punishment for disobedience was 200 lashes. If a black or mulatto was found with a knife or any more lethal weapon, the punishment was the same. All free blacks and mulattoes were forbidden to live by themselves. Black and mulatto women were forbidden to wear jewelry or silk. These became the special perquisites of Spanish women alone. And then in 1611, a female slave died, allegedly of maltreatment by her owner. At her burial, over 1,500 Afro-mestizos seized her body and marched through the streets calling for justice, finally assembling at the home of her former owner and throwing rocks through the windows. This led to arrests, whippings, and orders to slave owners to sell troublesome slaves outside of the colony. The leader of the procession, Juan Diego, had been involved in the previous plot of 1608. He called for a meeting at which a king and queen were elected, Pablo and Maria, and an uprising was scheduled for Christmas of that year, 1611, before companies of infantry arrived bound for the Philippines. So the plotters pushed the date back to Holy Week of 1612, believing that the religious observances would provide cover and a distraction for the uprising. Money was pooled so that each rebel would be armed, and the plan was that all men would be killed, and the women and children spared to act as servants. Once again, this was a coalition of slaves and freedmen. And once again, bad luck. Two Portuguese slave traders overheard a slave woman angry over a Spaniard mistreating a black man say, "All Spaniards will be killed in the Holy Week, and the city will belong to us." The traders threw an anonymous note through the window of the home of a member of the Audiencia, the High Court, with the result being the suspension of all religious processions for the Holy Week, the closing of all churches in the capital and nearby towns, and the arrest of all men belonging to cofradías, organizations of men whose task was to care for and arrange religious icons, pilgrimages, and ceremonies. Good cover for secret plotting and organizing. Spies were also placed in prisons to eavesdrop for tips. Then a Spanish woman overheard one slave scold another for speaking too freely about the rebellion. They were both arrested and tortured, and from their confessions, the locations of caches of weapons were uncovered, which in turn led to banishment or death for the plotters. On May 12th of 1612, 35 were hung and then drawn and quartered in the Zocalo, or the town center. Seven of them women. Drawn and quartered means that their arms and legs were tied to four horses, who then pulled them until they were pulled up in the air. Then they were chopped at each joint by four men so that they were pulled apart into pieces. Not to mention the head. Six pieces, four limbs, a head, torso. Grim. A grim way to go. After this spectacle was taken care of, all cofradías were suppressed permanently. No slave, free black, or mulatto was allowed on the streets of Mexico City between the hours of 8 p.m. and 5 a.m. No funeral could be attended by more than 8 mourners of non-Spanish descent, otherwise 200 lashes would be meted out to those in violation of the law. Within 30 days, all free male blacks and mulattoes had to find a Spanish sponsor who would attest in writing to their good character or face 100 lashes and 5 years forced labor in the Philippines. Women were forced to serve without pay in a hospital, convent, or obraje workshop for 2 years. Anyone found selling any weapon to any slave, free black or mulatto, would die. Period. No Spaniard, regardless of rank, could be accompanied into the street by more than 2 black or mulatto slaves. If there were more than 2, these slaves would be confiscated and sold out of the colony. Lastly, 2 permanent companies of soldiers are created to stand guard at arsenals, powder deposits, and prisons. These events marked the end of attempted rebellions against the colonial government. Several factors point to the reason for the ending of these bids for freedom. First, the punishments and laws put in place had to have had the desired effect, which is to say, the creation of a strong cautionary tale for anyone who might try to organize another revolt. Second, the early 1600s were a time of increased immigration from Spain to the colony, and as the number of Spaniards began to balance out against the numbers of those of African descent, it would have the chances of success for any rebellious enterprise less likely. Third, the increased occurrence of these slave-based plots against law in order to discourage the purchase of more slaves, and so the numbers of bozales dropped off dramatically. And finally, After 1600, the Indian population finally began to rally and grow after the tremendous toll taken by the epidemics of the 1500s. And as the Indian population grew, the need for a labor source from outside of the colony, and a dangerous one at that, became far less pressing. So, of course, far smaller numbers of African slaves are being imported and brought into the colony. In closing, it may also be of interest to note that the majority of slaves involved in these events were bozales. And today, in Mexico, the muzzle shown on the dog to the right to prevent it from biting is called a bozale. Momento. Pardon me, guys. Okay. Purity of blood and the casta system in colonial Mexico. The Spaniards had established colonial Mexican society on the premise that it would consist of two separate republics, La República de los Españoles and La República de los Indios, each with its own separate legal codes and court systems. But within a relatively short time, a much more complex reality emerged, whereby the colony of New Spain was populated not simply by Spaniards and Indians, but by Africans, as well as mestizos, who, along with a host of other mixed-blood minorities, were classified under the collective term castas, or castes. But in spite of the above, when one looks at the census of the 1600s and the mountain of other official colonial paperwork that still exists, one can find scarcely any real mention of the mestizos and other castas. They are lost in the great mass of information regarding Spaniards, Indians, and Africans. So perhaps the first great challenge is to explain, pardon me, the obscurity of the largest of the castas groups, that being the mestizo. Initially, in the decades following the conquest, mestizos did not form part of any third community or element distinguishable from Indian and or Spanish society. Mixed bloods though they were, they lived either as Indian or Spanish, depending primarily on the darkness of their skin. Those mestizos born within wedlock or born of higher status Indian mothers or who were adopted for some other reason by their fathers were absorbed into the first generation of criollos. Furthermore, a significant number of first-generation mestizos, both legitimate and not, were raised as Spanish gentlemen and ladies. The crown approved of this process, for it was thought that the Spanish presence in New Spain should be thus strengthened. But a considerably larger number of mestizos were born to casual unions between Spanish men and Indian women, and these children were generally raised as Indians. By the mid-16th century, many Indian caciques were, in fact, biological mestizos, the offspring of noble women. When the term mestizo began to appear in the late 1530s, it referred to marginal individuals, persons of Spanish Indian descent who were not full members of either group. Indeed, in the early colonial period, the word mestizo was synonymous with bastard. By the 1600s, terms like mestizo and Indian were losing their biological meanings and increasingly becoming cultural identifiers. A mestizo might not be a person of mixed ancestry, but simply an Indian who had achieved a social identity that meant he no longer had to pay tribute, whereas an Indian was one who, in the words of Luis Rodriguez, lived in an Indian community, spoke an Indian language, spoke Spanish with an Indian accent, wore Indian-style clothing, and/or participated in Indian-style fiestas. By the late 17th century, a new mestizo culture was being formed in and near the Spanish population centers. By the middle of the 18th century, it would become the dominant culture in much of the rest of the countries. And you guys see this painting, you're going to see about a dozen more through the next batch of slides. These paintings were called castas paintings, and they were created as like educational tools to sort of show to reinforce to the population, particularly like the middle class population, and that, you know, this is what these particular kind of people look like, and this is how you get them. You know, basically, the Spaniard and the Indian produce a mestizo. Like, this kind of person, when they marry this kind of person, it creates this kind of person. You're going to see as we go along, it's going to be explained. But I want you to understand what these paintings mean as we go along. Just follow along. It's going to make sense to you. Okay, just as many Indians moved up the social scale by becoming mestizos, many mestizos did the same by becoming Spaniards, which in turn darkened the criollo strata. This was dangerous for the social order, as throughout the colonial period, the Spaniards justified their control over the population by stressing racial differences. As it became clear that the boundaries between the two republics were blurring, the authorities looked for a new system by which to make sense of and control the colony's diversifying population. From its inception, New Spain's three-tiered division of labor had been drawn on racial lines. Spanish merchants and property owners, Indian laborers, black slaves, and domestic servants. But the high rate of miscegenation or racial mixing challenged not only the labor system, but the Spaniards' very claim to authority. Peninsulares already looked down on the criollos due to the Indian component in their ancestry, and the criollos were anxious to avoid any further taint to their racial status. To this end, in the 17th century, the Peninsular and Criollo colonial elites developed the Sistema de Castas, or the System of Castes, which at its most extreme would distinguish more than 40 racial categories, although the standard format of the time would generally include 5 to 7 groups, ranked most often as follows: Spaniard, Mestizo, Castizo, Mulatto, Morisco, Indian, Black. Only slightly more complete list of castas from 18th century New Spain look like this. Now you guys can read through those. I don't need to read them all off to you. But it's this list that corresponds with these images. This is number 3. If you go back to number 2, number 1... Okay, so you can see them, 1, 2, 3, 4, and you can kind of look along, blah, 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 okay. You read through these, they're just, it's fascinating stuff, okay, but read them on your own. Now, there were many variations on the status and treatment of the various groups and specific definitions, varied from region to region and over time, although the first 5 groups were always arranged in the same order. Many Indians had more prestige than most mestizos by virtue of the large tracts of communal land they held title to. But socially, Indians were beneath mestizos, who were, in turn, beneath Spaniards. Most mestizos were barred from high and mid-level positions in the royal and ecclesiastical governments and barred from the clergy, except in frontier regions where Indians and mestizos would be their parishioners. Sorry. The voice is going. Free Afro-Mestizos had the same legal rights as mestizos, but were socially stigmatized due to African blood and considered to be inferior to both Indians and mestizos. They had to pay special taxes due to their blood, and in central Mexico were forbidden to walk on roads at night and from carrying weapons unless employed as private guards. Worst of all, in Mexico City, their inability to pay bills or status as a pauper was punished by indentured servitude. Although the racially mixed populations increased in number throughout the colonial era, status had much to do with the father's social position and legitimacy. Children whose fathers were Spaniards of high standing, but whose mothers were women of color, were often given the status of criollo, and priests would only record the name of the father in birth records so as to affect this same fiction. But commoners seldom recorded the same privilege. The idea underlying the Sistema was the concept of limpieza de sangre, or cleanliness of blood, which had been used in Spain to force members of the upper class to prove that their ancestors had not been Jews or Muslims. In the New World, however, this would be used principally in reference to racial identity. The Sistema not only assigned a name and rank to various types of mixtures of blood, but offered the possibility of improvement of bloodlines through the right pattern of racial mixing. According to this scheme, if a European married an Indian, his mestizo offspring would belong to a lower caste than himself. However, a mestizo family could become whiter by marrying Europeans in later generations. The offspring of a mestizo and a Spaniard would be a castizo. The child of the castizo and a Spaniard would revert to a Spaniard. If a mestiza married an Indian man, her child would be demoted in the social scale and might be labeled as a sali atrás, or a jump backward. Crazy, right? But even this primitive form of social control had its limits. By the beginning of the 1600s, Spaniards were forced to hire castas to fulfill their labor needs. As the castas became integral to the colonial economy, it became difficult to inhibit their social mobility as the sistema had intended. Economic expansion allowed for unintended upward mobility. Lower class castas could just shrug off the absurdity of the sistema de castas, but the upwardly mobile castas felt the full impact of Spanish racial ideology and were thus especially jealous of their buena fama y reputación, the good name and reputation, right? They wanted their family to look good. They sought to whiten themselves through intermarriage with white-blooded Spanish families and or through the purchase of a cédula de gracias al sacar, or a certificate of whiteness, which could be purchased from the government for a goodly sum. This practice came into being because by the 1700s, there were so many claimants to white status that something had to be done to appease them to maintain order. Over time, it was wealth and not race that became the primary determinant of social position. Interracial marriage increased in Spain to the point in 1776 where the crown was forced to pass laws intended to curb the practice, and in 1778 these measures were extended to the colonies. Now all white minors were required to receive permission to marry from their parents or guardians. Further, to circumvent the church's ancient insistence on free marital will, the crown mandated that all cases arising from this legislation be heard in civil rather than ecclesiastical courts. But money had already had its say in the colonies. The parental objections that were filed were overwhelmingly to do with race, with class-based concerns rather than issues of racial identity. By this time, the Audiencia, the highest Spanish court in the Americas, refused to define race on the basis of physical appearance or biological heritage, but defined it rather on the basis of social standing, which had to do with the scratch, with the money, with the dinero, with the pesos, right? When it was wealthy, whatever his physical appearance was Spanish, and race was only useful as an index of social status in the absence of wealth or influence. If physical appearance was at odds with social status took priority. The sistema de castas was abolished in the late 1700s because it had failed entirely in its mission to establish social controls in New Spain. By this time, the dual process of Hispanicization and miscegenation had undermined two successive Spanish racial systems. Within 100 years, Mexico would begin to think of itself as a mestizo nation. Okay, full pause, guys, for one sec. Almost done. Now, here are some helpful ways to look at not only the socio-racial stratification of colonial Mexico that was organized by way of the casta system. I should have read that a little differently, but it don't make sense. The peninsulars and creoles or criollos are at the top, right? Let me use my little finger, right? Basically sharing power. The peninsulars have more governmental power if we were talking about, well, if we're not talking about racial power, we're talking about racial power. Let's stick with that, okay? So they share power, right? Peninsulars here, the criollos here, okay? More or less co-equals in power in different ways, with the mestizos and the poor white criollos kind of co-equals the next level of pyramid. It has generally been argued over the centuries that criollo status automatically elevated one status above that of any mestizo, but this was not necessarily the case. A light-skinned mestizo whose white parent or grandparent, for example, was of good lineage would often be perceived as being better than one of pure Spanish blood who had somehow allowed himself to fall into a lesser economic station. And then again, as we just discussed, money changed everything, but okay. On the third tier are the many other mixed-blood castas, only about half of which are shown here, simply for the sake of clarity in the image. I'm not going to, you know, write 8 different or 20 different other, you know, mixed-blood castas in here, guys. These are the main ones. Below them reside those of pure African and Indian blood, whose status could also be altered through acquisition of wealth. You know, another way you could parse this out is that Africans were absolutely below Indians. But that becomes debatable depending upon how you parse it out. Okay, now below this is another pyramid that I drew, just to give you a sense of what sort of status occupation would confer. Okay, these are not absolutes. They are generalizations that are largely accurate, okay? And you can just kind of mull this over and look at it and, you know, use it however you might. It doesn't apply completely to this chapter, this lecture, etc. But it seemed like a good place to pop this in, so I did so. I popped it in. Now, this is an interesting piece of sculpture that I came across. It's in Mexico City. I don't know the artist. The title is Monument to Mestizaje. It's Cortez and Malinche with their first child, Martin, flanked by the Lion of Castile, the Eagle of Mexico. And I thought it sort of went along with this quote by Richard Rodriguez, the very famous Mexican-American, the most famous Mexican-American author. The essential beauty and mystery of the color brown is that it is a mixture of colors, right? It's a great piece of art. I hope to see it in person someday, but anyway, kind of puts a period on the end of all that discussion of the early racial history and sort of creating the racial foundations of early Mexico and etc. Now, a few more things to talk about before we're done with all of this. I want to talk about religious syncretism and the Virgin of Guadalupe, Our Lady of Guadalupe. One of the first orders of business for the Spanish after the defeat of the Aztecs was to get all of the Indians within their immediate sphere of control baptized and under the guidance of the church, the control of the church, really. Mass baptisms began in 1523, and the work only went as slowly as it did because of the small number of priests that were there relative to the hundreds of thousands of Indians living in the Valley of Mexico who were, from the Spanish point of view, urgently in need of saving. Right? Or conversion. In 1524, a group of Franciscan missionaries arrived who were referred to. Cortez gave them a kind of title, the 12 Apostles of New Spain. They were only the first of many waves of clerical immigration that would arrive in the colony year after year following 1524 to disseminate or spread the word of God. Now, the process of turning the Indians of New Spain, polytheistic believers in gods who represented and were associated with colors, directions, elements, and aspects of the natural world, into monotheistic believers in the one true God, right, was no easy task. But the Indians made it seem easy, because most of them, for the most part, went along with everything so willingly. They allowed themselves to be baptized. For the most part, they didn't even know what was being done to them, but they did know that they were being threatened with violence if they did not allow themselves to have their heads held underwater for a few seconds, so why not? I mean, literally, they had these lines, hundreds of Indians long, you know, going into the church. They were forced, like, literally physically, you know, sort of threatened with violence to line up, you know, and into the church, and so here you come up to the place where you get baptized, and there's a couple of tough guys there, you know, conquistador guys, tough guys with big knuckles, you know, and you come up, and the priest is going to, you know, do the thing and this and that. They want to stick your head in the water, and if you resist having your head stuck in the water, the guys, right, you know, one way or another, they're going to stick your head in the water. It's literally like an assembly line of conversion, okay? You know, the Indians tell everybody what's going on. Look, let them stick your head in the water. Otherwise, you're going to get a black eye and a bloody nose and whatever. So, yeah, right? You know, and after this, they sort of learn, you know, they come to church on Sunday to Mass and they pray. Conveniently, the Spanish built the early Catholic churches and shrines on the foundations of Aztec temples that they had destroyed. So many, if not all of the Indians, just closed their eyes and prayed to the old gods when they were in the new Catholic Church. The Spanish did not know this until much, much later, but that's what they were doing. Now, not all the Indians. A lot of the Indians, seeing the old gods defeated, destroyed, wiped out, seeing their cultures destroyed, the collapse of everything. You know, I mean, they became legitimate converts. They said, yeah, we lost. Our gods lost. The new god is the one true god. They became legitimate converts. But many of them did not. They faked it, okay? But the Spanish didn't figure this out for a long time, okay? At times, the priests could see that certain Indian beliefs and practices were being blended together with Catholic doctrine and tradition. And for the most part, they tolerated this as necessary. Remember, at this point in time, the Catholic Church was over 1,000 years old. And the word Catholic means universal. In other words, Catholic Church means the church for everyone, everywhere. And what that had always ended up meaning for 1,000 years was that wherever the Catholic Church went, wherever it spread, whatever new land it was exported to through missionaries, whether it be Ireland or Turkey or China, it picked up new elements. It blended into itself some local flavor in order to establish itself, to bring the people to it, to work, to succeed. This was a big part of the church's success, and things would be no different in Mexico, where indeed this syncretism, this ability to blend two different sets of beliefs and create a new, slightly different belief system would be tested as never before in the long and complicated history of the church. And nowhere is the syncretistic nature of Mexican Catholicism more evident than in the story of Juan Diego and the Lady or the Virgin of Guadalupe. In 1531, a young Indian and recent convert to Catholicism, Juan Diego, was walking to the church in Tlatelolco when he heard birds singing all around him. The world shone with brighter colors, seeming lovelier than he had ever seen it. He heard a voice calling him from Tepeyac, a hilltop near where the Spanish had destroyed a temple to the Aztec earth goddess Tonantzin, our sacred mother. She was an aspect of Coatlicue. There he saw an apparition of the Virgin Mary, who spoke to him in Nahuatl, telling him to go to Bishop Juan de Zumarraga in Mexico City and tell him that she wished a church to be built in Tepeyac. Well, I'm sure you can imagine, you know, a dude beat feet, right, with all due speed to see the bishop. But the audience didn't go well. Zumarraga didn't believe his stories. What are you talking about? Get out of here, right? What are you crazy? So Juan Diego went back to Tepeyac, and the Virgin told him to return the next day to see the bishop again. In that meeting, Juan Diego answered a lengthy series of questions, and the bishop told him he had to provide a sign from heaven to prove the truth of his story. So the third time Juan Diego saw the Virgin, he went back to Tepeyac, right? He was distressed over the illness of his beloved uncle. She told him not to worry, that she was with him and watching over his uncle, and in fact watching over all of the people of New Spain who might need her care and protection. Further, she told him to climb to the top of the hill of Tepeyac, and there, in the middle of winter, he found many flowers growing that he had never seen before, and she instructed him to take certain of them into his tilma, his cloak, and only to open it, wrap them up and not open it until it was in the presence of the bishop. So when he went to the bishop and opened his cloak, the flowers fell to the floor, revealing the image of the Virgin on the cloak itself. And under the flowers, there was a picture of the Virgin. And as if this was not enough of a miracle, the flowers were Castilian roses, a particular kind of rose from Spain, not known to grow in America, only growing in Spain, specifically in the region of Castile. The bishop apologized for his unbelief, took Juan Diego's cloak for safekeeping, and the next day accompanied him to Tepeyac, and there began making plans for the construction of a great shrine to the Virgin Mary. Juan Diego returned home to find his uncle in fine health, and this is considered to be the first of the lady's many miracles in Mexico. Thus was born the cult of Our Lady of Guadalupe, La Virgen de Guadalupe, which embraced all of the people of Mexico in the coming decades and centuries, giving them a syncretistic divinity, a specifically Mexican Catholic icon to believe in, and spurring religious movements that sought to give indigenous meaning to the gods, saints, and ceremonies of the Catholic Spaniards. As late as 1575, or the Catholic Mexicans, I should say, let me correct that. As late as 1575, the reproduced image of the Virgin was of a Spaniard with slightly darkened skin. But sometime after that, her likeness changed to its current form, which is, more often than not, a brown-skinned mestiza. In addition to that, the Virgin used flowers as her accoutrement, which were, for the Aztec, symbols of all that was fine and beautiful, and in particular, marigolds, that flower was the particular flower of the Virgin. The specifically Mexicanized image of the Virgin is one of overwhelming magnificence, even in its humblest iterations. Her mantle, and go back and look at the images through these last 10 slides and you'll see what I mean. Her mantle or shawl is the firmament, yay, of the blue heavens themselves, scattered with all the stars of the cosmos. She stands upon a crescent moon, and from behind her, on all sides, the rays of the sun shine out. Because in her transcendent glory as the Mother of Christ, she eclipses both the sun and the moon, right? Which is darkened. In 1737, during a great plague, Guadalupe was made the patron of Mexico City, and 9 years later of all New Spain. Thus, the Virgin of Guadalupe became the most powerful symbol of an emerging mestizo nation. And during the War of Independence against Spain, which began in 1810, the rebels carried banners with the Virgin's image, and the rallying cry was, "Death to the Spaniards, long live the King, and long live the Virgin of Guadalupe." Here are some additional pictures of her. Next couple of slides. In 2002, Juan Diego was beatified under the name Saint Juan Diego Cuautlatoatzin, the Talking Eagle, and to this day the Virgin Mary is called Tonantzin through a large part of Nahuatl-speaking central Mexico. This is a mural. All these murals and these past images are from Los Angeles, most of them downtown or East LA. This is one from East LA where you see Juan Diego like a local, you know, homeboy, right? And here you see a poor Indian, you know, naked, right? I mean, stripped down to nothing back in the day here, right? In the primal time, the first appearance of the Virgin as a mestiza here. I mean, really in need of protection. Here you see her portrayed as very specifically calling it like it is, Tonantzin Guadalupe. Here's a detail from one of the many great murals by Paul Boteo, okay? The Virgin Seed. Beautiful, amazing mural. Take my History 44 class. You'll learn a lot more about this. And if you live in LA, you'll actually go out and visit it. Check it out. Dig it in person, baby. But enough about that. There's a great mural by the great, great LA muralist, George Yepes, the Lady of the East Side, okay, where you see the Virgin as, you know, a mestiza from LA, where she's her shawl. It's the flags of all the nations of the world, with the Mexican flag at the top, front and center, the American flag just beneath it. And she's holding it up, the shawl up, almost like a woman trying on a dress, right? Almost like looking in a mirror, like, oh, is this going to look good on me? With this expression on her face of infinite compassion and love, right? And a kind of halo of the sun here shining out behind her. Because, again, she blots out the sun. She eclipses the sun in her magnificence and grandeur and beauty. Here you have a small detail from another extraordinary and enormous mural, Tenochtitlan, The Wall That Talks by John Zender Estrada, where you see the Virgin sort of syncretized into an ofrenda of the Day of the Dead, Dia de los Muertos. We don't have time to get way into this. And then a couple of paintings from way back, The Virgin of Guadalupe in the Castas by Luis de Mena, or Mena, in 1750, where the Virgin is presiding over a bunch of Castas paintings, you know, right? Sort of legitimizing the Sistema de Castas under the watchful eye of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And then here, the Eternal Father, God, painting Guadalupe. I mean, too bizarre to even comment on, but entirely fascinating, nonetheless. Now, a couple things about this artist. There's a few images earlier on, but a bunch more here. this great, great artist, one of my favorite artists, perhaps my very famous favorite artist in the history, the great, great history of Mexican art, Saturnino Arán. Many of you may know of the great triumvirate of Mexican artists that became famous in the 1920s following the Mexican Revolution, Los Tres Grandes, the three great ones, Diego Rivera, Deborah Alfaro Siqueiros, and Jose Orozco, known the world over for the tremendous art that they produced in the years and decades following the Mexican Revolution over the course of the next 30, 40 years. Frida Kahlo, very important, but not part of that, of their movement particularly. She was kind of off to the side of it. Some other important artists that came out of that period, Rufino Tamayo and Jorge González Camarena, who I'm going to talk about in just a minute. But there were a couple of artists that came about before the revolution that were deeply influential upon those post-revolutionary artists. One of them, the great lithographer Posada, and this guy, Saturnino Arán, who tragically died in 1918 of a misdiagnosed stomach ailment. He may have lived to be the greatest of them all, in my opinion at least. Very little of his art survives. For me, again, he may be the greatest of all the Mexican artists because for the first time in the history of, let's call it Mexican art, even going back into the colonial era before it was technically Mexico when it was New Spain, you know, you could chart the history of let's call it Mexican art from the time of the conquest. You know, let's say it starts in the 1530s. So you got 1617, 1830s. You know, when he started painting in the 1890s, you had a tradition of art that had been around for almost 400 years, well over 350 years. And never in all that time had anyone treated the common folk of Mexico, and especially the Indians of Mexico, with dignity and with respect as a collective of human beings that possessed a culture and a lifestyle that was worth portraying in art, worth celebrating, and worth recording, until Arán came along. I don't have the room or the time here to show you the great breadth of his work that I could show you, because I have a lot of it. What I want to show you at least is this, the stuff that survives from his last great achievement. He had gotten this great commission from the government to create a series of murals that were to be called Our Gods, to sort of show who and what the Indians were in terms of their religious identity at the time of the conquest, and who and what the Catholic Spaniards were in terms of their religious identity at the time of the conquest. He had completed charcoal sketches, very detailed as you can see here, and then sketches done in colored pencil that he, in some instances, had filled in with watercolor. He had also done a few paintings and two murals that survive in the National Theater. But for the most part, his grand vision remained unrealized because, again, he died. It just kills me. Only one book has ever been published, and nothing in English. The only way I was able to get all these images was I bought the book in Spanish. $500 on eBay. This enormous book with these big fold-out illustrations. I took it to Kinko's. I scanned everything. And then I returned it because I told the guy I didn't realize it was in Spanish and I couldn't read the text. And I know that sounds horribly dishonest, but I paid for all the postage so the guy didn't lose any money. But I can't afford $500, guys. I'm a teacher, but I needed those damn images so that I could share them with you, right? But here it is. I just wanted to share this with you because it really speaks to what we're talking about, the syncretism, the particular melding of Indian beliefs, Spanish beliefs, Spanish Catholicism, you know, the Indian traditions of Mexico. There's no one that's ever really celebrated this stuff in quite the way that Hernan did. And the beauty of his art is so extraordinary that even incomplete as it is, it's some of the most breathtaking stuff that anybody ever, that anyone's ever executed. If there's any fairness in the universe, we would have this, but the universe doesn't care, right? This is a big 8-page fold-out in the middle of a book that just, you know, that's as good as I can get it for you. Just the two sides coming together in one. Just amazing. Just look at it. Look at that. And look at that. Look at that. Syncretism in action. Coatlicue with an Indian Christ blended into the midst of it. A crucified Indian version of Christ. Just... And now we have a few images here, again, with the idea of syncretism played around with often throughout his career. A great muralist who came around about a decade after Los Tres Grandes, Jorge González Camarena. He played around with this idea in many different ways. This is called Racial Encounters, Encuentro Racial. Here you have the idea of the conquistador and the Aztec warrior, right? The idea of these two different warriors sort of coming together to form something different in a sense. Or Teocallis, the temples, two different kinds of temples, a Catholic church, right? An Aztec temple fusing, blending to become something different. Teocalli Mexicano, Mexican temples, similar theme, slightly different and darker execution. Mestizaje Arquitectónico, Mexican architecture, again, similar theme, different execution. The fusion of races and cities, Fusión de Razas y Ciudades, right? This is something that Camarena dealt with throughout his career. I wish I had dates for these images. Sorry, I don't. I'm sure that you're fine with it. And one last thing. My wife and I went to Guatemala for several weeks. You could bail out right now if you want to. Not going to be in the exam, but I think you might find this interesting. And we went to see the Black Christ of Esquipulas. Esquipulas, Guatemala, is a town name for the chief of the Chortimaya Indians who, rather than resist the Spanish, decided to surrender to their superior power peacefully in order to save the lives of his people. It was our old amigo, well, maybe not amigo exactly, but you remember Pedro de Alvarado, who founded the town in 1525, naming it after the chief for having saved all of them, you know, some heavy bloodshed. In 1594, a traveling woodcarver admired the basilica, but thought that it needed a better image of Christ and decided to take on the task of carving one from local wood, making of it a gift to the people of the town. Some decades afterward, the Christ turned black, and this was hailed by one and all as a miracle. In point of fact, it has been determined that the wood from which the Christ was carved has a particular chemical property that, once dead, causes it to turn black when removed from the naturally humid conditions of the forest, but don't let that allow us to get in the way of a good story, right? Okay, now, Archbishop Pedro Pardo de Figueroa was cured of a life-threatening ailment by the Black Christ in 1737. I wasn't there, but that's what they say. And every year since then, tens of thousands of pilgrims come to Esquipulas during Holy Week every year to pray to the Black Christ for healing. Hey, if you look back here, guys, all these crutches, canes, leg braces, all this, and this is only some of them. There's like 10 times this many. They are all here because the people that used to use them don't need them anymore because the Black Christ healed them. All of these medallions, and there's way more than that, were purchased and mailed back to Esquipulas, to the church, from people who went there, prayed for a miracle, got back home, and a day, a week, 3 weeks, a month or something later, they were healed by a miracle from the Black Christ. That's what they say. And that's why they went to the time and the expense and the trouble to mail these things, okay, you know, back. Okay. As you make your way towards the Christ, along the winding path that takes you through and from, decorated with artworks made by artifacts given by and photos of those whom the Christ has supposedly healed, I have to tell you that it becomes increasingly difficult not to believe in the story. It begins to take hold of you until one feels possessed by it. When you get to the rooms where all of the crutches and canes and leg braces hang on the walls, mementos mailed or brought by hand to the basilica by those who are no longer lame, who now walk, run, and dance the Macarena under the sun and by the light of the moon. Well, brothers and sisters, children of night, who among you does not wish to run with the hunt? Let me just say this. It takes a stronger man than I am to bear witness to all of that and say that there is absolutely nothing to it. When you are there, even if you are the most devoted atheist in the world, I defy you to not buy into it, at least to some degree. I'm not an atheist. I'm not some hardcore believer, and I'm certainly not an atheist. All I'm telling you is that when you are there, you can taste the belief in the air like it's mouthfuls of fruit. There's something about it. It's pretty fascinating stuff, okay? And actually, there's one last thing. I want to recommend to your attention a film that you may never have seen, and that film was called The Mission, directed by the great Roland Jaffe, and starring Robert De Niro and Jeremy Irons, released in like 1988, 89, somewhere around there, 1990 maybe, right back around there. Anyway, it's a great film about the effort by the Jesuit priests to protect isolated populations of Indians in the interior of South America from slave raiding parties sponsored by the Spanish and Portuguese governments in the 1700s and their successes and failures and what happens to them. And it's just, it's a really stirring and emotionally involving and spectacular film. And if you like great films that deal with history, and especially deal with history on a nearly 100% level in terms of, you know, like historical honesty, the film is pretty right on the mark. It's not 100%, but in terms of the big picture, you know, particulars, it's pretty right there. I really recommend it to your attention. I think you'll enjoy it. And in fact, if you rent it, Netflix, however you might get your hands on it, and you don't dig it, I'm giving you a money-back guarantee, guys, okay? Write me like a paragraph, an email, say it sucked and this is why or whatever. I will PayPal you, or in some way or another, I'll get your money back to you. I've shown it to students year after year after year after year in my classes, and they all dig it. They cry. They love it, okay? So there you go. Have a great day. Talk to you soon.